You strength in your mighty name. And our peace in the darkest day remains. Jesus.
I know he's led me through the night. Let's sing.
And this we know, we will see the come.
celebrate your faithfulness, your goodness, your mercy. That you so relentlessly pour out on us in a place that we don't deserve, but God, you meet us right there. And we're so thankful, Jesus. We're so thankful for who you are. Thank you for meeting us in the mess, in the place where we needed you desperately. So this morning, God, would you speak to us? And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, you can be seated.
Well, good morning, church. It is great to have all of you here at the Springdale campus. And right now, we are actually linking together all of our campuses. So those of you at Fayetteville and Pinnacle Hills, we are glad to have you here as well today. We're linking up just for this first part of our service because we have something very, very special to do here in just a moment that we wanted to pull the entire church together to experience with one another. And let me just begin by talking about what we call the Decade of Love. The Decade of Love is our 10-year vision for our church of how we are going to go about reaching Northwest Arkansas, America, and the world for Jesus Christ. And God is already doing so, so much. And before I even get to it, I just want to stop and say thank you, church. Everything that I'm about to talk about is a result of your faithfulness to be a part of this church, to serve, to invite people, to share the gospel, to give to this church. And so thank you, church, for your support and for your generosity. We've been in a very unique last 7 weeks as a church. You may or may not realize this, but over the last 7 weeks, we have seen almost 500 people be baptized as a church. Isn't that crazy? It's some crazy, I think it's 485 or something like that of people who've been saved and been baptized, or those who are getting the baptism on the right side of their salvation. So God is moving in an incredible way. Part of the Decade of Love is that we wanted to plant 10 churches over the next 10 years in strategic cities around the world. Yesterday, I got a text from Thomas West, our church planter in London. They actually meet right now on Saturdays. They're about to launch officially in the fall, but they're already holding gatherings. And he says, Nick, he says, we had a Portuguese woman put her faith in Jesus yesterday in our service, which is an incredible praise be to God. And this is really what brings us all to this moment of why we're linking up today. Our goal over the next 10 years is to send 50 people from this church somewhere around the world. We believe that God can do more, but we're going to start with 50 that God will call around the world to be a missionary. And earlier in the, when was that? Spring, I guess it was, spring. We commissioned our first two out to San Diego, Shane and Chelsea Shower. Today, as a church, we get to commission missionaries number 3, 4, and 5. Would you welcome our brand new missionaries to the stage right now? I'm gonna introduce each one of them. This is Kylie Stancliffe, first of all. Let me tell you a little about Kylie. Kylie just graduated from the U of A in May and was part of our C3, which is our college ministry there at the Fayetteville campus. She'll be moving to Chiang Mai, Thailand, and teaching at Grace International School, which was created to provide a high-quality Christian education for the children of international workers located in Southeast Asia. So she'll be taking care of the kids of missionaries. Really cool. School's primary goal is to allow these families to continue to work in their fields without having to compromise the education of their children. Kylie, we're so excited for you. Kylie plans to be on the field in July. We're so proud of you, Kylie. Next of all, we have Kirk Kellogg. Kirk will graduate in just a few weeks from this year's School of Ministry right here at Cross Church. Kirk and his wife, Lisa, will be moving to and working in the Washington, D.C. metro area to reach Sudanese Muslims. Kirk has previously served in Sudan with the International Mission Board and has never lost his love for the Sudanese people. When you talk to Kirk about reaching Muslims from Sudan, he just tears up and about starts to cry. He'll be serving as a missionary with Global Gates Ministry and as a church planter through the North American Mission Board and the Virginia Baptist Conservative Convention. Kirk plans to be on the field in August. Kirk, we've so enjoyed having you here the last year, and we look forward to commissioning you today. Would you give it up for Kirk? Our third missionary, and if you're watching from Spring or from Fayetteville or Pinnacle Hills, you're not going to see our third missionary, and that's on purpose. Her name is Mary. She graduated from the Crusher School of Ministry last year, and Mary is going to an area of the world where her security is of primary concern. She's going to be doing kingdom work in a very difficult place. We're not even telling you where that is, but with the full assurance that God has called her and will fulfill his purposes in and through her work. She plans to be on the field in early fall this year. Would you give it up for Mary? Well, church, this is a pretty incredible picture here of living out, reaching Northwest Arkansas, America, and the world for Jesus Christ. And these three right here are getting pretty serious, wouldn't you say? And this is the fulfillment of the vision of the Decade of Love. And so if you ever wonder, man, what are we really doing as a church? Is this thing really operating as it should? Is it running? Are we fulfilling the Great Commission? Missionaries 3, 4, and 5. Today. We praise God for that. So church, here's what I want us to do. And regardless of whatever campus you're at today, as we commission these three out, I want you just to reach out your hand towards these three as just a symbol of us as a church sending these two women and this one man out for the ministry of the gospel across the world. Lord Jesus, today we lift up Kylie, Kirk, and Mary. We thank you for the opportunity that this church has had to invest in their lives. And Lord, today we commission them into the field to fulfill the great commission that you've given us. Today, Lord, in light of Acts 1:8, we pray that the Holy Spirit of God would be upon their lives. Lord, that you would reach them, you would use them to reach people in Thailand, in D.C., and in the place where Mary will go. Jesus, we trust you to meet every need that they have. And Lord, we as a church send them today, but we don't release them today. We keep them in our prayers. And Lord, may they always know they have a church full of people who are here just holding the rope as they go and serve God across the world. God, we send them into your world today for your purpose. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Well, church, let's give it up one more time for these three. Really excited. Well, that's a good way to start out church, is it not? And I do want to, we let Fayetteville go just for simulcast. We didn't like let them officially go, but we're still here tied together with Pinnacle Hills. And so right now let's grab our Bibles and man, what a word we have from the Lord for you today. I want you to find the Old Testament book of Amos. You say, what book is that? Okay. Don't be ashamed if you need to go to the table of contents right now and find this small obscure book in the Old Testament. And what I want you to know as these people walk off the stage and what they would tell you if they had the microphone today, I think they can confirm it. You're all very ordinary people. Is that right? Extremely ordinary people. And that is so in line with where this message leads us today. We're just a few weeks into a brand new series on 6 of the 12 minor prophets that we have called Have You Read My Book? And we've titled that because one day you're going to be in heaven and you're going to be walking around. You're going to see this guy. He's going to be like, hey, my name's Amos. What's your name? I'm like, well, my name's Joe. And he's going to say, you know what? I actually wrote one of the books of the Bible. What'd you think of my book? Have you read my book? And we're trying to prepare you for that moment, okay? We do not want you to be embarrassed in heaven. And so today we study this guy's book by the name of Amos. I don't know if you've ever had feelings of not measuring up spiritually. Anybody be honest enough? Like, okay, I definitely feel a bit of inadequacy here. You look at people maybe in your small group, maybe you look around on a Sunday morning setting like we're in today, and you look at somebody else, and you're like, okay, God uses those kind of people. He doesn't use people like me who struggle with things like me, who come from family backgrounds like I came from. And we all have these feelings of inadequacy when it comes to serving God. And as I said, if you ever have had those feelings, you are very much in line with this guy named Amos, okay? If you're a note taker, I want you to just go ahead and give you the main point of our message today. I'll come back to this several times through the message, and this is why I referenced it with our missionaries here. God uses ordinary people to do extraordinary things for him. God uses very ordinary people to do extraordinary things for him. Think about just this simple truth in other parts of the Bible. Remember what the Bible says in Acts chapter 4 about Peter and John? It says this. It says, now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated common men, in other words, they were extremely ordinary, they were astonished and they recognized that they had been with Jesus. Very ordinary people that we put high on a pedestal, but back in the day, we would have looked at them and thought, wow, there's really not much to these two fellas right here. Remember what Moses said when God called him to go to Egypt? This is Exodus chapter 3. Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? We could go on and on and on, both in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, and think about almost every man and woman of God who were used by God, and we would see a similar vein. And here's what that similar vein was. Those who were greatly used by God in the Bible often thought they were the least qualified to be used by God. Let me say that to you again. Those who were greatly used in the Bible often wrestled with the thought that they were the least qualified to be used by God. This brings us to this guy named Amos, a very ordinary man, and you're about to see that right here. Let's look at the very first verse here in the book of Amos, which talks about this guy. It says, the words of Amos, who is among the shepherds. That's even interesting in itself. It's not like he's the main shepherd. It's not like he's the head shepherd. He's just one of the shepherds right here in a place called Tekoa, which he saw concerning Israel. So this is a book about Israel, prophecy about Israel, in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah, and in the days of Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king of Israel, 2 years before the earthquake. Here's what we see right off the bat here in verse 1 of Amos chapter 1. Amos was an ordinary man. If you need to know anything about this guy, it's that he's an extremely ordinary person. He is just a shepherd. Now you can imagine in that day, shepherds were not looked upon highly. In many ways, they were the normal of the normal, not lifted up in society or looked upon as highly gifted. These were people out in the fields. They spent most of the time with animals. They were extremely ordinary. Here's how ordinary Amos is in the Bible. Amos is not mentioned anywhere else in the Bible besides his own book. That's how ordinary this guy is. He's from a place called Tekoa that we don't even know anything really about. All we know is it was about 10 miles from Jerusalem. That's the extent. So you've got a very normal guy from a normal place. In other words, this guy is not making the NWA Business Journal 40 under 40, okay? He's not one to look after. He's not one that people are saying, oh, we got an up-and-comer out in the field right there, this guy named Amos. Kind of an odd name, but yeah, I think he's the next one, right? Nobody's talking about Amos like that. And who does God decide to use to give a message to his people? It's a very ordinary guy by the name of Amos. In fact, towards the end of the book, if you look over at Amos chapter 7, there's a guy named Amaziah who is upset with Amos. And it basically his message is this: who are you anyway? Like, who are you, Amos, to be speaking to all of us? And in a similar vein of being a very ordinary guy, here's how Amos replies in verse 14. He says, I was no prophet, nor a prophet's son, but I was a herdsman and a dresser of sycamore figs, okay? Like, again, this is not a guy who even thinks highly of himself. He's like, listen, I'm not a prophet. I'm not a preacher. My dad wasn't a preacher. He wasn't a prophet. I'm just an extremely ordinary guy. I was in the field. Then God called me. I don't even know why I'm here. I'm just giving this message to you, Israel. That's the story right here of Amos. Now, we've all had an Amaziah in our lives before, probably. People who didn't believe in you, who thought maybe you were beyond where you should be in serving God. And even think about, remember the story of King David when he is anointed king? Remember, Samuel shows up at the house of David, and his dad rounds up all of his brothers, but who's in the field? Who is it? David. And he doesn't even call out and be like, "Hey, David, there's a guy here looking for a king. Come on back in." He didn't even bring David in. He goes through all the other sons, and Samuel's like, "Oh, it's not him. It's definitely not him. It's not him. It's not him. Is there anybody else?" And he's like, "Well, I got this guy in the field. Got a son named David." Remember the story, God has him brought in, and he is the one anointed king. And even what 1 Samuel 16 just reiterates what we're talking about today. Here's what God told Samuel: "For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the what?" Call it out. On the heart. In other words, God doesn't see like you and I see. We look at people who are extraordinarily gifted. Like, of all the people in the church who God's going to use, it's that man, it's that woman, it's certainly not me. And God just has a different economy that he works off in. And he says, "Listen, I am the one who looks at the heart." Amos was kind of like David here, a guy who had been overlooked for just being a shepherd. He had every reason in the world to be insecure about the calling that God was giving him. I just look over here at our soon-to-be missionaries, and I say, every one of you probably also have reasons to be insecure. Like, "Well, I don't think I'm very good at this, or I'm not very good at this, I'm not very good at this." And I just want you to know that God can work through those feelings of inadequacy, and God will give you everything you need for the journey that you're heading on right now. I believe Satan feeds off of insecurity in our lives, especially when it comes to thoughts about serving the Lord. And let me just give you what I'm just going to call Satan's strategy of inadequacy, okay? And I want you to just listen. I'm going to name three of these, and I want you just to identify, have I ever heard that in my own mind? Have I ever believed that lie from the enemy? Here's how Satan works in our own minds related to inadequacy. He'll tell us, number one, you have the wrong gifting. Satan wants you to believe that you are not gifted to do what God has called you to do. We often think there are other more qualified people that could do a better job than we could, and so that hinders us from stepping into obedience, into serving God in some area of your life, because you're like, "Well, surely there's better people for this assignment than me." You probably heard this famous statement before about God's call. Someone once said, "God doesn't call the equipped, he equips the called." So if you're in your own life and you're debating, "Man, I feel like God's wanting me to do this, but I don't feel like I'm really adequate for that thing. I don't feel like I'm really gifted for that thing. And maybe God will call someone else who's already equipped to do it." That's not what you need to be worried about. You need to step into obedience today, and God will give you the equipping necessary for your calling. Many times we're so focused on the equipping or so focused on some qualifications that we completely miss what it is that God wants us to do. We think to ourselves, "There's no way I could ever lead a small group. There's no way that I could ever serve God and share the gospel at my workplace. There's no way a group of teenagers would ever want to hang out with me in the student ministry. Like there's no way that would ever happen. I have the wrong gifting for what you're asking me to do." Let me give you my own life and my own story. When I was really kind of in my college years, I had a real hard time doing what God called me to do. I'd surrendered to ministry, and yet I was terrified of preaching. It's a tough assignment, right? I would get sick, and honestly, during my college years, I battled panic attacks. Maybe you're one who has battled that, maybe even battles that today. And it often came up while I was about to preach. Now that's a bad deal, right? Nick, I've called you to go preach, and then every time I would preach, I'd feel like I was going to die. Flat out die and throw up all over the stage, okay? And I can remember, even those of you at Pinnacle, I was preaching one summer. I think I was doing an intern here. And I was preaching in the old building, like that strip mall building where Pinnacle began. And it was student ministry. I mean, so it's summer and student ministry. There was probably not 30 kids there, okay? And 28 of them ain't listening anyway. So what am I worried about, right? And so I remember showing up early, and I'm going through my notes in my Bible, and I am just sick as a dog, just like, I am so nauseous, so I can't do this, so nervous, I'm pacing, I'm kneeling, I'm sitting with my head on a table, like I am just ruined, about to speak to 30 middle schoolers and high schoolers, okay? And I can remember even the preaching was a disaster. I think I preached about 5 minutes and was done. Maybe 10, but 5 I believe was more likely. And it was just a disaster. It was embarrassing. And maybe you've been in the same shoes that I was in. You have so much fear, so much anxiety, so much stuff in the way that can easily be an excuse or an obstacle to serving God. And here's what I want you to understand. God will give you everything necessary to fulfill the calling of God upon your life. Everything necessary. Whatever it is he's calling you to do today, whatever's going on in your family today, God will give you everything you need necessary for the journey. And so I stand up here, a lot of years later, and I've seen it happen in my own life. There's a period where I could have thought, man, I have the wrong gifting for what you're asking me to do. I just had to get through Satan's strategy of inadequacy in my own life. Maybe you battle that first one. Think about this second one. You have the wrong temptations. You ever heard that one from the enemy? You ever believe that lie? Satan wants you to believe that you can't serve God because of your own temptation with sin. And let me tell you something that's true. This is true everywhere here at Springdale. It's so true at Pinnacle as well. Satan wants you to feel isolated and alone in sin. He wants you to believe the lie that you are the only person in the church struggling with that specific sin. The Bible says that there is no sin that is not common to man. In other words, every sin that's battled with has been battled with by somebody else. He wants you to believe that you're so alone and you're so dirty. And what a shame it is that you would even show your face in this church when you struggle with blank. Can I just tell you? Lie, 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 lie. There are people all over our church that I really believe are sincerely believing the lies of the enemy today. That lie is you can't serve God unless you're living perfect. Can I just tell you this? If you wait to serve God until you're perfect, you will never serve God. Can I just be honest with you? You know how many times I've on the front row had a moment of repentance with the Lord? There have been many times in my marriage where we're repenting on the front row together, like, hey, I'm sorry about that argument last night. Yeah, I'm sorry too. I shouldn't have said, I'm sorry. I believe God is much more concerned with being a quick repenter than he is with being a perfect liver. You have the wrong temptations. Can't serve God. You're the only one. That is a lie, lie, lie from the enemy. Think about a third strategy of Satan's strategy of inadequacy. He says lies like this. Well, man, you have the wrong family background. You have the wrong family background. Many are of the people in these two rooms were not raised in church, okay? Many people in our church were raised up in dysfunctional families. Some of you are like, amen, preacher, I can't say that out loud, but it was really bad, okay? And so when you get in an environment where the goal is health in all areas of your life and God's moving you to a place of health, it's easy to look back on your life and say, man, I don't know if I'm supposed to be here because of all that I'm from. And I don't know enough of the Bible like these people do, and they all seem perfect, like they've never battled anything in their life. Can I just assure you about our church for a second? Like this is like a good and a bad thing, but ultimately it's a good thing. Guys, be real honest about the people, including the preacher, who are at the church today, especially if you're brand new to our church here at Springdale or Pinnacle, and you're like, man, what kind of place is this? Let me assure you, this church is made up of messed up people who've been saved by the grace of Jesus Christ. That's what it is. That's Cross Church in a nutshell. Let me assure you, the guy who's standing up here has had so many issues through my life and still has issues that I have to work through to be able to serve the Lord. Are you getting the point here? Amos was an ordinary guy. But God gave him an extraordinary calling. He could have easily bought into the lies of Satan and bought into the strategy of inadequacy, but he still served God. God uses ordinary people to do extraordinary things for him. I wonder in here today who's battling not stepping forward in obedience because you felt inadequate. I wonder who in here is not serving God in some capacity because you have believed the lies of the enemy upon your life. Amen. I hope the word of God just sets you free today from a guy who lived 2,800 years ago, that your story can be like his story as a man of God in our church, as a woman of God in our church, as a teenager in our church, a child in our church, that God can use you just like he used this guy. Well, let's talk more about the story here. Not only was he an ordinary man, but Amos had an extraordinary calling. He had an extraordinary calling. What was the calling? Well, again, if you look towards the end, you look at chapter 7, here's what Amos says. He says, "But the Lord took me from following the flock, and the Lord said to me, 'Go prophesy to my people, Israel.'" So what was his calling? Leave your calling as a shepherd, and I've got a new calling for you to give a prophecy, to be a prophet to the people of Israel. Now we'll get to the prophecy part here in just a second, but I believe this gives us a beautiful picture of salvation, does it not? God took me from here, and now he's called me to do this with my life. Amos is saying, I used to be this, but now God has directed my life. He has redirected my life towards this. That there is story after story after story in both of these campuses today of people just like me, just like you, who have the same story of like, man, I used to be in the business all for money, and then God saved me. Man, now I see what I do Monday through Friday as the ministry that God's given me. I used to be about this type of sin in my life, and then it just overwhelmed me. I bought hook, line, and sinker into it, but then God saved me, and he's redirected my purpose in life towards this. What a beautiful picture this is of what God can do. When God saves you, he gives you a new purpose, a new identity, and a new direction. And there are people here today, both at Springdale and at Pinnacle Hills, who, if you're honest with yourself, you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ personally. And if you're wondering, well, Nick, what's the difference between what you say y'all live and what I live? It's the fact that God changes our direction. He saves us, gives us a new purpose, a new identity, and ultimately a new direction. What was the calling of Amos? His calling was essentially the same as every other Old Testament prophet in the Old Testament. He was to go and prophesy judgment against the people of God because of their sinful lives. Again, here we are. This is the third week in a row. What's the message week one? Judgment. What's the message number two? At least some part, judgment. Here we are, week three, judgment. Like, we could have called this six-week series in the summer, Repent, the Judgment of God is at Hand. Makes you want to come to church for those 6 weeks, does it not? We put a lighter spin on it. Have you read my book? But that's really what it is over and over and over again. Think about it. He got called from a place of obscurity. Man, I'm just a shepherd. I spend a lot of my time with animals. And God says, I'm going to take you from being a shepherd of sheep to my sheep. And I've got a message I want to communicate to my people. Look back at Amos chapter 1 again, verse 2. He goes into this attitude of judgment here. He says, and he said, the Lord roars from Zion. That's a picture of judgment upon the people in the Bible. And he utters his voice from Jerusalem. The pastures of the shepherds mourn, and the top of Carmel withers. As I just said, Amos is another book in this line on judgment. And here's the interesting difference about Amos and some of the other minor prophets. Some of the other minor prophets, it kind of is weaved through the book, this idea of a hope in the midst of all the judgment. Amos doesn't do that till the final five verses of the book. Isn't that interesting? It's like judgment, 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 hope. And that's it. Like, that's the story of Amos right there. As we've been telling you the last few weeks, our tendency is to look at these, you know, there's 12 of them. We studied Jonah verse by verse last summer. Now we're studying six more together. And our tendency is to look at small books like this, prophetic in nature, that honestly, when you read them for your quiet time, you're like, bro, I ain't got a clue what this is saying. Like, I'm just wrestling with this. I'm battling with this. What does it have to do with my life? And we think, well, that's not relevant for my life today. And can I just be so honest with you? There could be nothing further from the truth. The Word of God is living and active, every part of it inspired, every part of it important for your life. Even parts of the Bible that the pages are stuck together because you never read them, even those books God wants to speak to your life about. It's interesting, as I mentioned, Amos was written about 2,800 years ago, about 760 BC, before Jesus ever came. And when you think about what the prophecy was about, that God was going to bring judgment upon the people of God, you say, well, why was he going to bring judgment upon the people of God? Well, that's what I'm about to talk about here. It doesn't sound like ancient Judah or Jerusalem back in the day. It sounds like America in 2021. So it's wholeheartedly applicable with what I'm about to tell you right here. Let's talk about this together. Why was God going to bring judgment upon his people? Let me give you a couple of things. Number one, they were consumed with materialism. They were consumed with materialism. Anybody already seeing the headline of America right there? Consumed with the stuff of this world. You see, as you look at the historical nature of this timeline here of Israel, this was a time of peace in the land of Israel. And given the dysfunction of all the other countries that surrounded Israel, Israel had risen to prominence. And because of their ability to trade with other people, money was flowing. Said very simply, the economy was at a high place, and those who had wealth were sitting in a very good place. They were consumed with stuff, with the materialistic things of the world. Number two, this is a big one. In their materialism, they were treating people wrongly. They were treating people wrongly. You know, these first two things are connected, by the way. Whenever stuff gets prioritized, people get deprioritized. Whenever material things get prioritized, people get deprioritized. And the privileged in Israel were taking advantage of the poor. As you read the book of Amos, you'll see Amos speaking of things like the poor being trampled, of turning aside the needy, of not caring about justice. Again, what a picture of our own place today. Third thing is this, and we'll park on this one for a little bit. They were living hypocritical lives. Living hypocritical lives. You say, a Christian living a hypocritical life? Even happened way back then. Love what Chuck Swindoll writes about this entire book. He says this about the people of God in Amos' time. He says, while their outer lives gleamed with the rays of success, their inner lives sank into a pit of moral decay. Everything looked good on the outside, but inside, things were decaying. Rather than seeking out opportunities to do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly, they embraced their arrogance, idolatry, self-righteousness, and materialism. It's a pretty harsh word, is it not? Many of the same people who were consumed with money and were treating people wrongly were the same people who would gather at the temple on the church day. This is where it gets like real personal for us today here at Springdale and Pinnacle Hills. Said simply, these were the people that were going to church every Sunday. They were living surface level lives of following God, but their heart was far from him. Remember what we said earlier from the book of Samuel? Man looks on the outward appearance. The Lord looks upon the heart. What that means is you and I can walk into church every single Sunday. We can have all the appearance that we're following the Lord, all the appearance of everything together in our lives, while inside we are sinking into a pit of moral decay. People living hypocritical lives is not new, by the way. Some of y'all are here today, you're like, you know, I've been out of church so long because all these people are hypocrites. That's America 2020, just a bunch of hypocrites. This is 760 BC, and people were hypocrites. This is not about a time in history. This is about the human heart, and every one of us battle hypocrisy. And God hates it. God's going after it right here. Again, a good reminder, we can live lives that appear very good on the surface, that appear to have all the right things in place as it relates to spiritual things, and yet our hearts can be far from God. It's been interesting to see even the testimonies of people who've been baptized the last 7 weeks, who many of them, that's their story. I did the church thing. I did the church game. I lived a spiritual life like on the surface, but inside my heart was far from God. Here's what Amos says from the Lord to the people of God in this passage. Amos chapter 5. Here's what God says to the people of Israel, his own people. I despise your feast, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. And the peace offerings of your fattened animals, I will not look upon them. Take away from me the noise of your song, to the melody of your harps, I will not listen. But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. You imagine God sending a prophet to Cross Church today with a similar message? I mean, what if Amos walked into our church and he's like, listen, guys, I'm just a shepherd like over in Elkins. But God sent me here to give y'all a message. And here's what the message is. I hate your Sunday morning worship services. I despise your tithing and how you volunteer with the church. For the love, please stop singing.
I haven't heard an okay.
So. I detest your worship songs.
Sweet. Let's
stop living hypocritical lies coming to church on Sunday when all the while you're treating people wrong. We'd all be like this before the God light. What just happened? You can do a lot of the surface level things that make people think you're following Jesus, but I just want to remind you, one of the main marks of a genuine follower of Christ is that they treat people right. That's what it is. You treat people right at the restaurant today after church. You treat people right at your business. You treat people right in your family. If they see any difference in the world, they see it in your life because you treat people right. Right, sounds pretty appropriate for us today, does it not? I'll close out with some hope in the midst of the judgment from God today. Let me give you two things that I think are so true, and with this I'll be done. God can use you even when you feel inadequate. I really believe there are many people here at Springdale at Pinnacle Hills who you've been holding back, and you have a desire to serve God. You know you should serve God, but all these feelings of inadequacy have held you back, and today needs to be the day that you step into obedience in whatever God's calling you to do. I don't know what that is. Could be something here at the church. Could be something with your family. Could be something else in your life, but step into obedience today. Here's the second thing. This is true throughout the Bible. God always blesses repentance. There's not one place in the Bible where a truly repentant person comes before the Lord and God says, nah, too much, too dirty. God always blesses repentance. That's the ultimate goal of this prophecy that Amos gives to the people of God in Israel, that they would realize the error of their ways and turn back to God. You realize that that's really why we do church every single Sunday, is that you and I would recognize the error of our ways and turn back to God. We meet weekly. Why? Because we need it weekly. This prophecy does give hope that there will be a group that turns to God. There will be what the Bible calls a remnant. And this is such a simple truth, but it's so good for us today to close on. Those who turn from the sin of their lives will experience the redemption of God. So simple and yet so true. There are some people here today who need to repent of the sin in your life. You lived your entire life for yourself. And maybe you've walked through the last 7 weeks of the journey that our church has been on, where so many people have been saved, so many people have been baptized. You're like, man, I know that that's me, but I'm struggling to like take the step. Today it's time to take the step. What are you gonna win? Another week of being miserable? Another week of God speaking to you saying, hey, it's time, it's time, it's time. Let me just tell you, today it's time. In just a moment, and don't come up just yet, but in just a moment at both of these campuses, we're gonna have our staff from our church, both men and women, just flood the fronts of this church for you. And if you need Jesus today, you say, Nick, I know that that's the step. I need to turn away from the sin in my life and experience the redemption of God. You come and all you have to say is, listen, guys, I need Jesus. And that man, that woman on our staff, they will lead you to faith in Christ today. Some of you need to be baptized. Would you come as well? Some of you saw these three missionaries. God's been working on your own heart about the calling that he may have on your life. Maybe God's been burning your heart with a call to ministry, a call to the mission field. Maybe today's that confirmation for you. Would you come and talk to someone? I'll wrap it up like this. When you take a kind of a 30,000 foot look at the life of Amos, here's what you see. Amos responded to God with surrender. Key word there is he responded. I said this last week at our Fayetteville campus, and for those of you at the 9:30 service, you heard me say it last week at Pinnacle as well. One of the most important spiritual disciplines that you can ever learn to practice in your life is the practice of responding to the Word of God. That's true in your own time with the Lord when it's only you and God, in the morning, late at night, whenever you read your Bible, and you read something, and man, you just know the Holy Spirit has grabbed your heart, and he's like, okay, that's you right there, that's what I'm speaking to you about. One of the most important disciplines in your life is to respond to the Lord. That's why we give a time every single week as a church at the end of the message. It's not just for fun. We give it so that the people of God can respond to the Lord. I want to ask you at both of these places, when's the last time your knees have hit one of these altars in response to what God's doing in your heart? Maybe today you know that God is calling you to do something, and as a visible picture of, okay, Lord, I'm stepping into obedience, I'm walking into obedience, you want to come and just say, Lord, I'm responding to your word today, and I'm going public with it. I'm going in front of people. I'm kneeling at this altar as a demonstration that I'm laying my life on the altar to be used as a sacrifice for you. When's the last time your knees have hit the floor in response to the word of God? Today, we're going to give you that opportunity as we close this service. I want us to pray together at both of these campuses. I'm going to ask now for our staff at Springdale and at Pinnacle to come forward. And again, they're here to receive you. Maybe you've got something going on in your life and you just want prayer for that. Man, you come. We'll put our arms around you. We'll pray for you. If you need Jesus, this is the moment. You are surrounded by people that are excited for you to serve God, that will be thrilled for you to stand for Jesus today. If you cannot stand in these two rooms surrounded by believers, how in the world will you ever stand tomorrow at your workplace or at wherever you're going? Let's pray together, and then we're gonna prepare to sing together at both of these places. Let's bow our heads. Lord Jesus, today we respond to the word of God. Would you bring people here that need to know Jesus today? Would you bring people here that need to take a step of obedience? Or would you bring people to this altar in response to you, Lord, that they're just stepping into obedience, whatever that is. Lord, would the Spirit of God take over these last few moments of these two services here? We trust you for that. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. We're here at Springdale. Why don't we stand together? And this is the time as we begin to sing, you come. There are already people here kneeling at the altar. You come and respond to God. These staff members are here for you right now. Let's respond together.
Thy strength indeed is small, child of weakness.
this watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. 'Cause Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Avery, I have one question for you. Have you turned from your sin and put your faith in Jesus?
Yes.
Awesome. Based on that profession of faith, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life.
In just a minute, we're going to dismiss. Let me tell you something that is just super special. I think Pastor Nick alluded to this. Over the last 5-6 weeks, we've seen just under 500 people who've been publicly baptized. On Sunday, July 4th, we're going to be doing baptism at the crosses. How many of you guys are excited we're doing fireworks at the crosses this year? For those of you, and we know many of you are new to Cross Church, for the last 10, 12, 15 years, at Fireworks at the Crosses, we do baptism at the crosses at our Pinnacle campus. And I just want to say, because we know there are hundreds of you in this last year that you have given your life to Christ, or even over this last season, the Holy Spirit has really convicted you. You need to be baptized. Pastor Nick is going to be baptizing at the crosses on Sunday night, Sunday afternoon, July the 4th. And we would love to invite you. Simple way that you can sign up is to go to crosschurch.com/baptism, and you'll see a simple sign up form there. We would love to celebrate. I can't think of a better day. I can't think of a better day to be baptized than Sunday, July the 4th. And what a great opportunity in front of lots of people there at our baptistry between the crosses. So we would love to invite you to do that. Also, let me say today, if you're a first-time guest, and I've already met several of you this morning, we have a gift for you at our Connection Center right through these back doors. And so I encourage you, if you are a guest, first-time visitor, come by, visit with us. We would love to talk to you. Or if today you gave your life to Jesus, maybe you prayed and you said, Jesus, I'm surrendering my life to you today. I want to follow you. Today I'm making my decision to become a follower of Jesus. Come to the Connection Center. Let us talk with you, pray with you, put a Bible in your hand, encourage you. But we just want to know that, man, we're so, so excited for you. So Cross Church, as always, we hope you have a wonderful weekend. Go Hogs. You're dismissed.
I want to thank you today for joining us online. Listen, if you need anything at all, maybe you felt compelled to give your life to Christ today, maybe you have questions about spiritual things, we would love to have you just text this number on the screen, 479-343-8777. You'll just text us your name and then text us what your question is or what you'd like more information on. We would love to get in touch with you and help you. I want to encourage you to check out crosschurch.com for more information on our church. We'd love to have you sometime in person here in Northwest Arkansas. We look forward to seeing you next Sunday.